Hi everyone, welcome to Adobe Live. My name is Cody and I will be your host for the next 2 hours. Today we are joined by the amazing illustrator Danii Pollehn. How are you doing today, Danii?
Hi, I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. I'm so happy to have you back for day two. I'm looking forward to what we're going to be working on today. But before we get going, I wanted to remind you that later in the stream, we'll be doing an artist spotlight segment. And if you would like to submit your own portfolio or a portfolio of someone you know, feel free to fill out the form at the top of the Behance chat. And I also wanted to say hey to everyone in chat. Hi, Val. Good to see you, everyone. Welcome. Thank you all so much for joining us today for day two. And let's see, I don't know if my chat is updating, but we will make sure. It looks like Behance might be having some chat issues today, but I'll just refresh my page. Hey, Gareth, welcome everyone. Hello. And also without further ado, I will hand it over to Danii and she can tell you about, a little bit about the work that she does and, a little bit about herself and her career.
Hi. Yeah, I'm so happy to be back and continue drawing today with you guys. And yeah, I'm Danii. I'm a freelance illustrator based in Hamburg, Germany. And yeah, I work as an illustrator and draw every day. I do lots of digital art with Illustrator or Adobe Fresco. And yeah, it's mainly vectors at this point in my career. And yeah, well, let me show you some projects I did recently. And yeah, for example, I did an illustration for a basketball court during NFT New York City. And yeah, they had my illustration printed on the court. And I thought that was pretty cool to see it here, like in the middle of all those, other
that
illustrations.
That is so cool.
Yeah. I was so sad I couldn't be part of the event, but yeah, it was super, super cool to see it like this big and people playing on it and like,
yeah.
Also I did a editorial illustration recently for a German magazine. It was two illustrations I did and yeah, there are vector illustrations to combine with some story and yeah, I like that very much. And also, what can I show you? Recently, I also did the Adobe Stock Artist Development Fund, which I created 500 assets for to have them included into the Adobe Stock Premium section to have them available for free for companies to like present underrepresented minority groups. I chose chronic illness and disability because I have the background of this myself. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's what I did.
That's so amazing. Yeah, it's so beautiful. I just absolutely love your work, Danii. It's just so vibrant and it just has so much character to it. And I'm really looking forward to seeing what we're working on today. And if you would like to swap on over to your artwork workspace, we can kind of explain what we are going to be working on today.
Yes, absolutely. Give me 1 second.
Sure.
So we sketched five. Oh, wasn't yeah? It was five women that are in dynamic positions, and let me just like I was already moving it. we decided on them. We checked the references and created these. We put some outfits on them, like flare pens, and put some flower patterns, and how can I say that? I finalized them during the day today, and now we move back into Illustrator to color them and finalize the illustration. So,
very cool.
Yeah, I created a couple palettes up front for us to choose from, and I'd love to know from the chat which color palette they like the best, or they would like to explore further, or if anybody thinks that we might need more colors to the palette, or if we should switch out some colors, or if something is missing. If anybody has some ideas, just let me know. Like, that's the first palette. I was thinking about how we could like so people could easier let us know which palette they
want. Yeah, you could put numbers on them, just really quick, maybe. But yeah, let us know in chat, everyone, if you have a favorite palette that you would like Danny to work in today. I think personally, I really like number one and number three. That's just me. I don't want to sway the chat too much.
Okay.
There you go. Now they have numbers.
Getting there.
Hi, Alessandra. Hello, everyone. Welcome, Karina, Dana. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Hey.
What's your favorite palette, Danny?
Probably going to be, I have to say it's four. Because that's very close to palettes I've worked with so far, which I would choose. And they have lots of different colors in them. But I also kind of like the first one because, yeah, it's like similar hues somehow. And there's lots of pinks and nudes. And that could be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that these two are my favorites.
Yeah, four is really fun too because it's just like really bright, like primary colors. Like, yeah, I think any of them would be really fun to work in. So I just love color.
Yeah, same for me. I can't live without it anymore. Yeah. Did you see anybody say something?
We haven't gotten any suggestions in chat. Val just made a poll. What do you think, Val? Do you have any opinions on these color palettes here? If not, we'll just have you pick your favorite, Danny.
That's all right, too.
Artist choice.
Yay! So.
Yeah, I think number one is fun because it's kind of like monochromatic almost. Oh, Val said number one. Val likes number one too, so.
Okay.
Go ahead with number one.
Okay. Yeah, it's also very feminine and
yeah
kind of like that. So yeah, then I will put my artwork onto multiply and reduce the opacity, but have it on top of all the layers.
Now everyone's voting for number one all of a sudden.
All right.
Yeah, everyone has said number one now.
Okay. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
Ooh. Yeah, then I put a little bit. Ooh. A little bigger in the corner so it's easier to access. All right. Usually I start by picking one, like whatever I want, and then we figure it out in the end what works best.
Okay. Sure.
Also, would you guys like me to add skin colors or should I resemble them from the palette we chose?
Oh, so you would make the skin tones directly from the palette or like more realistic skin tones?
Yeah.
That is a very good question. What do you guys think? while we're waiting for that, we also have a question in the chat that says, how did Danny settle on her design style? How did you end up coming about the way that you draw?
That's a good question, and it wasn't as intentional, I think. It just happened to happen. Yeah, I wanted to draw it like that, but also I didn't want to force something onto me. And yeah, specifically the time I started creating Woman More, I tried not to hang out on social media as much because like, if you want it or not, you get inspired quite a bit. And of course, I am inspired. Things are on trend. I can definitely see that. But also I wanted to find something that is more me, and it feels natural to do so, and not always like you have to recreate something what you're not naturally would have done, which would have been difficult. So yeah, I guess it comes naturally while drawing a lot. I think I did a 100-day challenge where I created something every day for 100 days. And then it started to really, how can I say that? After a couple of days, I just knew like, oh yeah, okay, that's the way it's gonna be.
Yeah, I think I've kind of gone through the same thing where when I do like Inktober challenges or Drawtober challenges in October, I feel like that's the most artwork I make at one time. And I kind of like really quickly am able to figure out different style changes because I'm making so much art within that 1 month, which I don't normally do. So my style gets more refined within that time.
Yes, exactly. It just happens naturally without even thinking about it. And then you realize like, oh yeah, I love to use these brushes or have the shapes this kind of way and it works really well. And yeah, I love the moment when it just clicks for yourself.
Yeah.
Also, that's the best. So satisfying.
I'm really liking this like coral color that you're putting on the pants. That's really nice.
Thank you. It's kind of vibrant, but it's kind of not. And it's, I don't know, but I like it. But yeah, maybe I should put some background color first.
All of these color palettes that you suggested for the stream today, have you used all of them before or were they brand new?
They're okay. Brand new. Yeah.
That's so cool.
So I always love exploring new color palettes and see how they work together and what kind of vibe they're like giving off and what you can create out of that.
Mm-hmm. Becca in chat says this looks like such a fun way to block in color. Could you explain like the tools that you're using right now to block in your color like this?
I use the brush, the normal one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know what it is in English.
but I think it's the pencil tool. Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, it creates those shapes. And then I always have to go back manually and redo them a little bit and put the, make them look a little bit better and maybe even delete some. But yeah, I really like the look that is coming out of that because it's kind of like, very clean but also not as clean as other vector illustrations because I'm not being over perfectionistic about it, but yeah, because usually I like when it's a little bit more wobbly or if there is like accidents that happen or like subtle mistakes, which there are no mistakes, but yeah, it makes it a bit more approachable, I think.
Happy accidents.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that that it gives it that more hand-drawn look and it kind of looks a little bit more traditional or relatable. It kind of adds more character in that way, if that's the kind of look you're going for.
Yes, exactly. A little bit more, that they are like their own person.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's lots of clicking and lots of pulling things and pulling path and points around to see what's the best way to put them. But yeah, I love that.
Yeah, this looks like a really easy way to get into Illustrator. Maybe if you're a beginner like myself, I don't really know much about Illustrator. I haven't really done much work in it at all. But watching you use the pencil tool right now, it makes it seem really easy. Like I could start doing this, just blocking in color really simply, just to try to start using Illustrator without feeling too overwhelmed.
Exactly. Because I think that's mainly the problem with the desktop version, which I also love, but it kind of like, it isn't that much fun if you love drawing a lot, right? Mm. So because it's more about like, oh, did I close the path? Did I do this? Did I do that? Is it going to work afterwards? Is this and this happening? I mean, by the end, the same result would probably come out, but yeah, it makes the thing so much more like intimidating and yeah, but you definitely yeah. should try it because
yeah.
It's perfect. I love it. And also, yeah, certain types of clients might want you to use it. And then there would be more offers for job probably. because that's what's happened to me, actually.
Yeah, I actually sometimes forget that Illustrator on the iPad exists. So I have it on my iPad. I just forget that it's there because I've just never used it really. So yeah, I'll have to try it out one day. Oh, I really like how you did the green for the hair. That's fun.
Yay. Yeah, I also like to like have weird colors in weird places where probably mm-hmm. nobody else would like to put them. But yeah, I think it's fun.
Those kinds of choices, I think, really adds to a personal style too. Like it really makes your style more iconic and recognizable when you kind of, like you just said, put colors in places that other people might not. And it's like a really personal choice to do that. So it makes people be able to recognize your style more. Val says, I feel the same. I don't really use Illustrator on the desktop because I like to paint. I illustrate in the iPad version. I really like that I can draw on the iPad in Illustrator.
Yeah. That's also, that changed the, because before it wasn't available for iPad, I wasn't using the program anymore at all. Because mm-hmm. During fashion school, we used that for technical slides and so I knew how it works and how to work with it. But yeah, I was just like, no, it's not going to be this fun. And when I'm super, super honest, I even hated it. During fashion school, I was like, oh no,
yeah.
I have to do this. And I really didn't like doing technical flats. And oh, yeah, it wasn't my thing at all. But as soon as it was available on the iPad, people were telling me like, oh, you should totally use that. That should work really, really well with your style. And I was like, no, I don't want to use that. But then I was like, all right, I'm trying. And yeah, I fell in love with it.
Nice. Yeah, that really gives me a lot of confidence because I felt the same way about using Illustrator on the desktop because I like to draw too. That's where I'm, where my art expertise is. So I really struggled like with using the pen tool on Illustrator desktop. I've never been able to understand the pen tool very well, but the pencil tool looks really fun and easy to use.
Yeah, truly is.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like the look is still quite loose, even though it's clean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did you say yesterday, I forget, do you ever add any shading to your work or do you typically just work in solids like this?
I do gradients. I will put them on later.
Mm-hmm.
I usually like do like the overall colors and then add gradients for shading. If I feel like it fits the illustration. Okay. Getting there.
Jennifer in chat says, It was the opposite for me. I was so used to the pen tool, but only recently worked with the brush and pencil tools. It makes illustration work so much easier and more professional looking. Yeah, you guys are really convincing me to finally actually open up Illustrator now. I've always been so afraid of it.
No need to be afraid. And yeah, I think it's awesome. Okay, let me put her in the folder. So we kind of start sorting it out right away.
So you made all of those elements on separate layers, and now you grouped all of them together. Is that what you just did?
Exactly. Cool. To somehow keep it cleaner, because by the end, it's going to be so many layers. And
yeah,
it's easy to lose track of where you're at. And especially because we have certain shapes that will be covered by each other, it's going to be so much easier to move the different sections around, like in the front or to the back, or it would be so difficult if I would just all those layers have them here unseparated.
I am not very organized when it comes to my layers, and I don't label anything. I usually end up having to hunt for layers a lot, and I think that I would save a lot of time if I was more organized with my layers.
Yeah, tell me about it. Aren't we all guilty of that? I mean,
yeah.
While you're in the flow, who wants to like name their layers?
Yeah, it's so true. You know, it kind of does bring you out of the flow sometimes when you're just wanting to go draw, you know, and then you have to stop and organize everything. And yeah.
Yeah, it's just not. No, I don't like it. Today, a friend just like sent over a meme for me. Designer's humor or something like that, because she taught me, we had a little lesson with Adobe After Effects because she is a super pro in the program and I want to learn so badly. So she explained a couple of things to me and she was like, yeah, it's best if you name your layers. And I was like, oh no, I really don't like that. It's so much fun. Like, yeah, but it would be so much better. Like, oh, I have to, maybe later. But yeah, of course, if it's client projects, for example, and it's about like doing animations afterwards, then of course I name everything,
right,
everything, group where I can put everything organized so everybody understands what's going on.
Right, of course. Yeah, if it's for a client, you're always extremely organized because the next person that handles your file isn't going to know what each layer is. So you want to be really super organized when you have a client. But for my personal projects, I am not organized at all.
Yes.
Becca says Illustrator is nice because your layers get separate automatically. Oh, I actually didn't even notice that. Yeah, whenever she makes a new shape, it's on a separate layer. That's really convenient.
Exactly. There's not as many mistakes happening with Pixel things. I mean, how often did I draw on the wrong layer?
Oh. And,
like, had a nervous breakdown afterwards and
yes,
destroyed hours of work. Oh my God. Yeah, each time was very time consuming to come back from a mistake like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
When you were coming up with your color palettes for the stream, how did you figure out the colors that you were gonna use? Was it just like a gut feeling? You just kind of came up with a bunch of different palettes, or
I usually have quite a couple of pictures on my phone because wherever I go, I take pictures of everything that I see that I like and then shoot it through Adobe Capture and extract the palettes and put them into my library.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you use CC libraries from Adobe Capture to figure out your color palettes. That's really cool.
Yeah, it just makes super much sense to have it all at the same place, kind of, and keep it organized, and then it's there. How do you do it?
Sorry, go ahead.
I remember that you kind of told me yesterday, but still, like, is there sometimes variety within the palette you're using?
Sometimes I will change it up a little bit, but I do keep my swatches just saved in Adobe Fresco. That's typically the program that I work in. I've kind of just developed my overall color palette over the past few years that I just use in all of my work. So sometimes I will use those colors and I'll just like change them up if I want a little bit of a different look for each piece. But those are usually like the base colors that I use for everything.
Yeah, makes total sense. And are you adding colors now and then, or?
Sometimes, not very often. I kind of like am a creature of habit. I kind of just stick to the same colors, but sometimes I'll add in new colors every once in a while. But not very often.
Yeah, if it works, right?
Yeah, exactly. I've noticed that you do a really good job of figuring out your values while you're working with your colors. Do you ever actually check your values, or is it can you just tell just by looking at it if you have good values or not?
I've never checked.
Nice. Yeah, you do a really good job with it.
Oh, thank you.
You're like, I don't even know what that means.
Yeah, kind of. I was like, well. Yeah, I don't. Yeah, maybe I should.
Yeah, so for anyone that's unaware of what values means, so values is the difference in, I can't think of the word right now, but it's like the difference in the lightness and the darkness of each color next to each other. So like, for instance, the bright pink hair on the light pink hair on the dark background. And you can tell the difference in that shape because there's a lot of contrast between those two colors. But if the value of the value difference of those colors was too close, you wouldn't really be able to tell the difference between those two colors when the image was in black and white. So you can actually check your values to make sure that the colors look right by looking at your image in black and white. Oh yeah, I see how you're like with the sandals, you're kind of like adding a variation to the green, like changing it a little bit as you work.
Yeah, and then I also have the green already for the gradients I'm going to put, for example, in the top of her or in her hair, maybe even. Yeah, then it's already all on the canvas, kind of. And I can just like use the pipetta? What is it called? Like
eyedropper.
Eyedropper, exactly. And was there any decision about the skin colors?
Nobody in chat mentioned it, so we will leave it up to you.
Okay, then I'm trying to go with the palette, and let's see how it turns out. Maybe we'll add skin tones later on, or...
I also just wanted to let everyone know that later in the stream, we will be doing an artist spotlight. So if you would like to submit your own portfolio or portfolio of somebody that you know, please feel free to fill out the form at the top of the chat on Behance. And we will be looking at a wonderful artist towards the end of the stream, like towards like the last half hour of the stream. Hi, Oliver, Noor, good to see you guys. Hi, Annika, hello. Thank you so much for popping in.
Hey.
Hi. I think that part of the fun of working with a limited palette like this is that you kind of have to start thinking outside the box of where you put the colors and how you use the colors. I actually do that for myself because I work in limited palettes. And I actually think it's really fun to figure out where the colors should go.
Yes. And there's always very much room to make adjustments later.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes the ones I tried to put or where I placed them initially, it doesn't work out anymore for some reason. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, yeah, I have to change the entire thing. Let's see. Okay.
Oh, I like how you're using the darker green for the arm that's in the back to kind of like add depth to the image, but at the same time, you're still only using solid colors. That looks really nice.
Yay, so good to hear. I might though put some gradients.
Mm-hmm. Also, if anyone's just joining us, we are joined by the amazing illustrator, Danii Pollehn, today. And we're just having a really chill session, just like doing some vector artwork. If you'd like to have us on in the background while you're working on some work yourself, feel free to do so. Go grab a snack, some tea or coffee or something, and just, you know, have a great relaxing time with us right now.
So this is how I would do it. I would choose one of those gradients. Mm. And then to have it separated here again for the colors, I would just put the lighter one from the face up here. So I have the other fingers in the darker green, which also is applied here. Which gives
that looks
it
great. Yeah.
A little bit of variety.
Noor says, I just got an ice cream cone. Does that count as a snack? That is a fantastic snack. Yes, it does. Definitely. I wish I had an ice cream cone.
Oh, yeah. That would be lovely.
Do you have any other hobbies outside of doing artwork, Danii?
I wish.
Too busy.
Yeah, at the moment it's yeah, I'm looking for something, but I don't know what so far. Usually I like doing sports a lot, but yeah, it's German winter almost already. Mm. So you can't really do anything outside. Then yeah, the gyms are open again, but still it's a little weird. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know what to do. Do you have a hobby?
I play video games a lot. I actually met my husband online while playing video games when we were teenagers. So we play games a lot together. And I like to cook and bake. Yeah, what else do I do? I don't know. Whenever somebody asks me what my hobbies are, I always forget what I do during the day.
Yeah, I like cooking a lot as well, actually. Especially because I'm a celiac, so I have to cook a lot.
Yeah, I actually have ulcerative colitis, which is a colon condition as well. So, yeah.
Yeah. So you know exactly how it is. Cooking.
Yes.
Is on. Yeah, what else? What could I do? Yeah, I'm dreaming about of moving to maybe a warmer country to spend more time outside and get active outside more. Yeah. I'd love to surf.
Oh, yeah. Cool.
Or ride a cycle more. But yeah, it's really difficult here because it's raining so much.
Yeah.
And it's unpredictable. So like during 8 months of the year, it's like raining every day, at least like once.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy. Hamburg people would know what I mean. Like it's I feel like it's always gray. Maybe that's also that I like to use so much color. There is so much gray outside, so yeah, I really also need it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite meditative, right?
Yes, it is. Yeah, I'm just enjoying watching you fill out these shapes with your pencil tool here. It's really relaxing to watch. And don't forget also, you guys, if you have any questions for Danii and her process, feel free to put them in chat and we can answer them to the best of our ability. Rob says, if I had spent as much time on art as I have on video games, I would be Kyle Webster by now. Kyle Webster is the creator of a lot of our wonderful Photoshop and Fresco brushes, and he is the Illustrator evangelist for Adobe. He streams on Adobe Live as well.
Yeah, I love his brushes.
Yes.
So many good ones.
How long does it typically take you to finish a piece from start to finish, like if you're working with a client or compared to like personal projects?
It always depends. I feel like personal projects take up much more time for me because, yeah, I'm always trying either new things or, I don't know, keep on exploring a lot. But yeah, it depends on the project and the level of detail that is needed, I guess. Yeah, how can I say that? Usually it's like if a client approaches you, then they most likely ask for 2 to 3 initial sketches or ideas, and then you would go from there. listen to their feedback and incorporate that one and make sure all the ideas are thought through. And it always depends also on what the time frame is or the schedule, and if it's needed really quickly or if it's rushed or if it's not, or it always depends. It's hard to say, like, but for myself, probably 2 days with doing the sketch and then like figuring out the palette. And usually I do like quite a few palettes next to each other and see what I like best and try to evolve in the process and always like figure out something new.
Yeah, I think that's really important while you're working, especially on, well, on personal projects, definitely. Of course, when you're working with a client, you try to create what they are looking for. But on personal projects, it's really helpful to be very intentional about, trying new things and pushing yourself to try new styles or just experiment with different colors and stuff to kind of like, because you never know what you're gonna find out if you're experimenting, because sometimes when you just try something new, it might work and it might not work. But if it does, then it might be something that, you want to incorporate into your style from now on.
Exactly. Or also, it's so important to create for yourself. And because that's the way you attract clients by the end.
Yeah. I know a lot of artists who have gotten clients through just them finding personal projects online. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, I think the most successful I was on Behance with my personal projects as well. And this is also, I always ask for pictures or images or from illustrations I did. So I know exactly what the client is looking for. And they usually send in projects I did for myself.
So yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah, it's very, very, very important. And I also post them there because initially I thought that it's more important to post projects on Behance. But I think it's equally important. So that's also why, because if I don't have commissions, because there's always downtime, it's super normal for us freelancers. And then if my friends ask me like, oh, but when you don't have a job, what are you doing? Like, I'm working.
Yeah.
But what? You don't have commissions right now. It's like, yeah, but I might have. And that's how it usually goes. Like, even if you don't have work, you're busy.
Yes, definitely. Annika in chat says, are there any tips from Danii for people who are just starting out and are afraid of sharing their work online?
Don't be afraid. Just start sharing.
Yes,
it's the process.
Exactly.
Yeah, you're going to be so proud of yourself, how far you've come. Like, of course, I always feel imposter syndrome creeping up. I think it will never end, probably.
Yeah.
I think that's just part of the profession somehow. And you have to start somewhere, right? And the more you post, the more attraction there will be. And the better you will get. I mean, don't be afraid. Just get it out with it, because it's we are our best or worst critics, and most likely others really enjoy looking at our illustrations.
Yeah. You never know what somebody is going to be inspired by, if you post it. I used to be really, really nervous about sharing my work online. I think, as we were talking about yesterday, I think streaming helped me with that. Never did I think that I would ever be you know, drawing artwork in front of an audience. I used to be the person that would be drawing in class, like covering my artwork with my hands so nobody saw what I was drawing, you know, like really nervous and embarrassed that I was drawing. Because I was just afraid of what people might say, like, oh, that's really bad or something. But I think as I got older, and I still even struggle with, you know, worrying what people might think, or, you know, worrying about the numbers on social media and stuff like that. But I've definitely gained a lot of confidence through showing my work and streaming as well. So there's a give and take there too.
Yes, exactly. And nobody is going to say like, oh, this is ugly, this is no.
Yeah. Yeah, the art community is online is very supportive. It's like you very rarely get somebody that, you know, comments on you. I don't think I've ever gotten like a really nasty comment that says, oh, this is terrible. Like, you shouldn't have posted this, you know, like everyone's very supportive.
Yes, exactly. That's also my experience. And yes, we really have to start somewhere. And yeah, I remember I was the same, always hiding my little drawings. I didn't want anybody to see. And even though I did my A-levels in art and design, we also had to like draw and paint a lot. And then we had to present it to the class. I was like,
no.
Yeah. Oh man, and I was so bad at it when I was like 17. I was like, yeah, I know, it's not as good. And after a year, everybody was like, please, like, we can't hear it anymore. It's just being ridiculous, Danny. Like, please, your artwork is okay. Okay, please stop excusing yourself. It's awful. And then I stopped doing it and, yeah, didn't feel good about it, but still, like, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's something that, especially when you're, you know, young, you're a teenager, you're kind of still figuring out life and drawing. Like, if you're an artist, like, you know, you haven't really figured out like what your interests are or your style or anything. So you kind of feel really insecure about everything that you make. So I can totally relate to not wanting to present in front of class. And then at the same time, that's what live streaming is too, in a way. So you can see how we have both come very far.
Definitely. Yes, yes, yes. And it was all because we started someday, we just like stepped over our own shadow. I don't know if it's a saying, but it's a saying in German. So yeah. And started doing it. And then it starts to feel more normal with each time you do it. And then you get used to it. And then you just share it and not think about it anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. So the advice is just do it.
Which is the hardest also.
Yeah.
But yeah, it all comes down to that one. Yeah.
Magdalene in chat is asking, as you're drawing the shapes in Illustrator, do you overlap two shapes? Or are you drawing like against the line to just match it up perfectly? Are these shapes like overlapping each other?
Yeah, they're definitely overlapping. Also, I kind of have in mind that I might want to do animations afterwards. So I always have to create bigger shapes. And yeah, we're going to do clipping masks later on when we do the patterns for the pants, for example. Then I will show how to do a clipping mask. This is how you create those edges perfectly. Because in the beginning, I didn't know about it. And then I started like to draw to the line and like zoomed in like crazy. And I couldn't get it right. And it creeped me out. And I was like, God, this has to be done better somehow. This cannot be the way.
Yeah.
And then I realized, yeah, this is not the way indeed. It's clipping masks.
Yes, yeah. Clipping masks are so helpful. I use them in my work as well.
The best. I would not know what to do without them.
Nicholas in chat says, I needed that advice today. Thanks.
Yay.
It's kind of crazy and cool at the same time to be able to see how many different ways you can use just a few colors in this palette. Like all of the characters' hair are different colors, you know, and their skin tones are different colors and everything. It's just kind of like mixing and matching in different ways to figure out how you want each character to look. And it's just a lot of fun.
Yeah. I hope I can do it.
Hey, you're doing a great job so far.
Sometimes it starts like getting difficult by the end, then it's like, I could use another color maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, usually it takes some like trying here and try something else there, and then it works out. And I feel like it always gets better the more I limit the colors.
Yeah.
Then it feels like the composition is much stronger actually than I thought it would be.
Yeah, it kind of feels like it has a theme when the less colors you use, I think, works well for your style. Magdalene, yeah, of course. They said, great to know. Thanks for answering my question. Yeah, of course. If you guys have any other questions, feel free to drop them in chat. As I mentioned earlier, we are joined by the amazing illustrator Danii Pollehn today. Yesterday, if you guys missed part one, feel free to check out the replay on the Adobe Live YouTube channel. We did the sketches for this illustration. We did all of the kind of like dynamic posing for the characters. And today we are blocking in the colors in Illustrator. And then later, Danii will also be adding some gradients to kind of change up the colors a little bit. And then later after that, we will also be doing an artist spotlight. So stick around for that as well.
Yeah, I'm gonna do her now and then we move on to clipping mask, I think.
Okay, sounds good.
So we can like touch base on that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And now I don't know which colors to use here anymore. In the menu. See, that's what I was talking about.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just about to say, you haven't used red for the skin yet, so let's start there. And that's exactly what you did.
Yeah, I saw it too. I was like, oh yeah, I didn't have that one yet. So yeah, but then I might have to change the pants of the lady with the green sweater. Mm. See, this is where it starts.
Yeah.
Because it's a little bit too much there yet. Yet, no. Might as well do this right away. Hmm. What could her pants be? We have lots of green there. Can't be pink, can't be that. Maybe the darker.
Maybe yeah.
That one. Ooh.
Yeah, because you haven't used like a big section of that color yet. So I think that will look good.
No, oh, see, it's in the wrong. Fine now.
Annika in chat is asking if you've saved your work yet.
No, I did not. Yeah, I'm a little bit afraid because my iPad got really hot. And that,
oh, no.
Yeah, that it might stop working when I start saving now. I'm like, maybe just leave this for later.
Oh, no, that's scary.
Yeah. But usually it works out. I'm just not allowed to do crazy clipping masks now. Like super, super crazy. But yeah. Usually it all works out. Especially because I think it also saves in the cloud on its own. I think I have that.
Yes, it usually does.
Yeah.
I've lost so many files over the years from like power outages and stuff. I think it's just a habit for me to just manually save my work every once in a while. I even do it when I'm working in Fresco, just to be sure, just in case.
Yeah, it's probably for the best. Yeah, luckily I didn't lose as much yet.
That's good.
I was always lucky. But yeah, when I work more in Photoshop, then yeah, I put on that it saves on its own every like a couple minutes, I think, in the background. So yeah, I'm pretty safe with that. Even if we have like we lose power or something is happening or my computer doesn't want it anymore, then yeah, it's still there. Like some version, which is like a couple minutes, which has been saved a couple minutes ago. So
yeah.
Yeah, I'm not too worried about it anymore. Did it happen to you when working for a client?
I think it has. It's been a while since that's happened. Especially now that we have cloud saves and stuff like that. But I think it's mostly been personal projects. I actually can't remember right now.
Yeah, that's definitely nightmare material.
Yeah.
I hope this never happens. I hope we didn't jinx it yet.
Oh, I know, right? Oh. Everyone, make sure you have autosave on your desktop apps and you have the cloud activated for autosave on Fresco, on your iPad apps.
Yes, please.
Just to be sure.
Okay, we kind of have...
Looks good.
The idea of how it's going to look in the end. And now it's like lots and lots and lots and lots of details.
Yeah. Looks great.
Thank you. So let's put some flowers in the pants.
Yes. Yay. Patterns.
Yeah. I think I'm taking the color of the top for the petals. Yeah, this didn't work out. But yeah, there's also what I like to do a lot is to do the flowers with the radial repeat.
Mm.
That's also a super cool tool. Oh, where did it go? Huh. Ah!
Oh, no. What's happening?
We jinxed it.
Don't crash iPad. Oh, what have we done?
Please don't. I don't understand what's happening. Yeah.
Did it freeze?
No, not yet.
Oh, no.
It did freeze.
Oh my goodness.
Okay. Yeah, I think I'm closing the program now and then opening it up again. I'm
gonna restart it. Oh my goodness, I cannot believe that just happened.
That's okay.
Well, hopefully it's saved.
Yeah, it should be. Usually it is.
Looks like we're good.
Yep, yes. We're good.
Okay. Woo! Crisis averted. It's hot in here right now.
Yeah, very, very hot. Okay. Why did it happen? Who knows? Probably won't figure it out. Okay. Now I'm super scared. Yeah, I can see that it's not too happy.
Oh yeah,
I don't know what it is, but yeah, we're moving on.
Well, that is a perfect example of why you need to have cloud activated. And this was totally all part of the plan. We were just, making an example for you guys.
It can happen.
Yes. Anytime, anywhere.
Yeah, but yeah, I'm happy that I don't have to worry as much anymore about these things. So we just could like log back in and everything was fine. Yeah, getting rid of some anchor points. All right. Maybe this is a little bit too far out. So I would do the clipping mask now, which is like you have to copy the shape you want to have the clipping mask for, then you have to put it over the elements you want to put within the clipping mask, then you have to mark them all.
Mm-hmm.
Go to this, and it should be like it's Schnittmaske erstellen in German, but it's like clipping mask, create clipping mask, probably.
Right.
And then it's perfectly inside the mask.
So helpful. Yes.
Yeah. And from here, I can just like group the flower and multiply. Oops. Why is it not working? Okay, this is why. Yeah, and just put it wherever you want.
Okay, so just to make things faster on you, just copy and paste the one flower that you made. Cool.
Yeah, makes much sense to me, like, too. It's just a flower, so.
Yeah.
And you can, like, scale it or transform. Mm-hmm. So it's always going to look a little bit different. Yeah, I think that's very helpful. That was a game changer when I realized that's how it's done. Like, No, it makes all sense. So, and I'm using the same in the other pan. So we're doing it again, copy the layer, putting it on top. I think I have to make, we can try if it works, if the flower is in a group, probably won't, but oh, it works. Perfect. Yeah, and now we can arrange something here. I think that's so perfect. I love it so much.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really cute.
That's how it looks.
Very nice. Yes. You did it so quickly with the clipping masks. That's really, really useful.
Yeah, absolutely. Best thing. I feel like one is missing here somehow. Maybe make a smaller one. Yeah. I mean, you could also like create a pattern and just like add the pattern in the pants, but I like the look better if you do it by hand manually. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit more like, yeah, happy accident can happen. I guess that's what it's all about. So, and we could also do a clipping mask for the top here. Pick the color. And I'm just doing something like that. It's really not clean or anything, or it's just very quickly done. Use the button again. Boom.
Nice.
And we have some more depth here as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now that we have the clipping mask for the sleeve, we can also put the shadows here. Pulling the color here. And it's automatically inside and like very beautifully and clean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I love that we can like drag and drop everything inside. It's the best. Mm-hmm. So same I would do with the face. Copy.
I love how you are adding the details. It's so simple, but yet it works really well. Just like those little bit of shadows that kind of just add more depth to the piece.
Yeah. So, because this is also in the clipping mask of the face, I continue working in here to keep the layers a little cleaner. Do the nose details. Deleting anchor points here and there, because it always looks better if there is less anchor points.
Mm-hmm. Kind of cleans up the shape, right? Like it makes it a little more smooth, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. Pulling those layers inside, and then we can almost close it. I think for the eyelid, I'm gonna do black, maybe.
Mm.
Add black to the palette. Okay. Or there's another way we could do that, which I also like a lot, actually. It's like choosing the other brush. It's the drawing vector brush, I think. Mm. And then have it a little bigger. That's not the one I wanted. Or, yeah, maybe the drop brush even. Yeah. Do it like that. I think it's a nice...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so you did the taper on the brush. That looks really nice. It gives a nice wing, really clean.
Mm-hmm. But you can still like go in and change a few things, which I think is nice.
Yeah.
A little bigger makes sense. And I can delete this one. Back to the pencil brush. Yeah, also like to do like a little white dot on the eye. I feel like it looks a little more alive.
Annika is asking if you can demonstrate that again, doing the eye shape. Could you show us step by step how to do that just one more time?
Yeah, of course. Happy to do so. I'm going to another character. Let's take this one. So we have two eyes to work on.
Sure.
A second. Where is she? Yeah. Okay. I would choose black in my case, then go to... Ooh. What was it called?
So you're going, in English, you're going from the pencil tool to the brush tool.
Yeah, and it's the brush with the paint pot on the side. I don't know what it's going to be translated to. Yeah, unfortunately, it went to like German by default. Mm. I couldn't even choose because my cloud is in German.
Oh, right.
I could change it for the desktop, but not for the iPad with the programs, unfortunately. Okay, yeah, I choose that brush, make it a little bit bigger. And yeah, just like, oh. Draw a line, and it's going to happen on its own.
Very cool.
Yeah. Maybe here a little bit bigger again. Oh. 13. Yeah, like that. Maybe that's a bit too big, but we can just reduce the size a little bit. Yeah. Super easy. The best, actually.
Yeah, that is so, so useful. Very big wings. I love it. It's very satisfying watching you make the wing. I wish I could make my makeup wings that easily.
Oh, yeah. That would be so helpful, especially like, the eyeliner, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, let's do the shadow in the face here too. While we're at it, switch back to the pencil brush.
Oliver in chat is saying that brush that you are using for the eyes, it's called the blob brush in English.
Oh, blob brush. Okay.
Blob brush.
Perfect. Thanks so much. Copying again, putting this in. Yay, it's the best. I'm so in love. Yeah, I think I'm gonna put a gradient here because there is a darker space for the shadow. And
So
I think that's...
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead. Just
I was just going to say, how are you applying the gradient again?
I go to... I create the shape. And then I go to the color picker tool. And you have it here up on over the color wheel.
Okay.
You can choose between the different gradients. In this case, I chose the one on the left side because it makes sense because I want the gradient to go from this side to the other. And you can also like change the where it's going to be the gradient. You could also change it to have the lighter up or like you can do literally everything or even like whatever you feel like. I think that's super easy and the best. Also better than it is in the desktop version. I feel like in the desktop version, it's a bit more, not complicated, but harder to like touch the points because it's so much bigger. So it's kind of easier to use here. Yeah. There's other gradients as well, but yeah, I think for this one, I thought this one is the best, but we can check the other ones with the pants, for example, because here, this is the gradient in the middle is the radial gradient. So you can have, I think, two colors, one in the middle and one out like on the...
Up middle outside.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And the gradient on the right is the one where you can choose lots and lots of colors. So
okay.
For example, I would want a brighter color in the front. Pick it from her pants. But I would want to add with a click a darker color here because it's the magic. So here it would be the darkest here.
I think that one is called the freeform gradient.
Okay.
In English. Yeah.
Maybe add a lighter one here again.
It reminds me of watermelon, the color of the pants with the green that you have.
Yeah. The green could be a bit more greener though, maybe.
Yeah. But...
Yeah, now you're free to like check out what you like the best with the gradients. Yeah, this is how it will look. I think it makes sense. Yeah, I think it's good.
Yeah.
We could also add a gradient here, I guess. Now that we start using them everywhere, maybe it's nice to keep it cohesive.
Do you ever add any other textures to your work or do you typically just stick to gradients?
I tried doing it so far, but I didn't find something that I liked. So yeah, but I'm constantly trying new things, but so far I haven't found anything that clicked, unfortunately. Yeah, but I'm on it. I have lots and lots of structures I've scanned in or my old watercolors I'm trying, or I have some like 100 sheets with marbling.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, these are all scanned in. But yeah, so far it didn't work out the way I want it to be. But yeah, potentially I would love to do that. Right. Yeah, much better with the gradient as well. I like it.
Just wanted to remind everyone in chat that in about 10 minutes or so, we are going to have the artist spotlight. So please stick around for that. And if you would like to submit your own work or the work of somebody that you know, feel free to fill out the form at the top of the Behance chat. So relaxing.
Yeah. I'm still scared though.
You're doing great. It looks great. Yeah.
That the iPad is not gonna be happy with me any further.
Oh yeah. At least we didn't lose any work. Nothing's happened yet, but I'm not gonna jinx it. Not jinxing it. Okay. I really like the shape of the brows that you're doing on your characters. It looks really nice.
Yeah, I wish I could have brows like her.
Don't we all?
Yeah. Unfortunately, back in the 90s when I was a teenager, I plucked them all.
Yes. Oh, yes. I know a lot of people that have said the same thing when those really thin pencil brows were in style back in the 90s and you overplucked your brows and now they don't grow back very much. Mm-hmm. Such a bummer.
Yep. So sad. Yeah, I was like, yeah, new insecurity unlocked.
Oh, no.
But yeah, I guess it's okay. You cannot have it all, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think the first one is almost there. Maybe I could do the background a bit because we had those kind of waves or dust waves kind of.
Yeah. Kind of like clouds or dust or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Because I wasn't sure how to do that, but yeah, I feel like I want to work with multiplying the layers, and like then the colors inside would change also. So let's see how that plays out.
Yeah, let's try that. That'll be fun.
Yeah, that's also the moment it gets really messy with the layers. Okay, let's see what it does. Yeah. I love using these. These are so much fun.
Yeah, the blending modes can really give you, it's kind of like one of those happy accidents, you know, it can really give you something that you're not expecting. Rob says, I'm curious as to how Danii is layering these with an eye towards animating them later. How do you animate your illustrations? What program do you use for that?
Yeah, usually I did a couple in Adobe Fresco or in Photoshop frame by frame. Yeah, and recently I started After Effects. But yeah, I'm not the best yet. I'm starting out though. I can do a little movements. I understand how it's working, what I have to set up in order to even use the shapes and yeah, then the effects and how to layer everything. And yeah, it's interesting. I think it's really cool. I really want to do more with it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Because you were saying earlier that you kind of overlap your shapes to give you a little bit of space to animate your characters, right?
Yeah. So we're not missing out as much. Yeah. I think that's a little bit too much. She definitely needs to be in the front, but I kind of like the change in the pants here.
Oh yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah, let's see what this does. Interesting.
I just love your casual attitude about just being willing to experiment and just say, oh, let's see what this does. You know, like, I think that that's a big part of what's fun about artwork, especially digital artwork, because you can always press undo if you don't like it, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Huh. Maybe this one works out somehow. Then she has to go to the front or maybe to the back. Let's see. Yeah, sometimes it's like hours of like putting it back and forth. And yeah, I probably won't be achieving the best possible outcome now.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. But it makes it a bit more interesting because the shapes are going to be interrupted and... Oh, let's see.
Yeah, I like how the character with the pink hair is behind the first cloud, but in front of the second cloud. So it adds a lot of depth. Even though we're using flat colors, it still has depth to the illustration. Oh yeah, now you're adding another one. Yeah, that looks really cool.
Yeah, let's see how this plays out, or if I have to put at least, we'll see. I might have to do this on top. Oh no, this is not working. Yeah, it's cool, but she has to come in the front again. But then, yeah, I guess I have to change her pants.
Right.
Because this was the color of her pants.
Yes. Very true, true.
Yeah, we're changing this up a little bit.
Very soon, whenever you're ready, Danii, actually, we are going to hop on over to our artist spotlight whenever you get a chance here.
Yeah, I think I'm ready. I'm going to switch to my prepared page. Just give me a second.
Sure. Yep. So we're going to hop on over to Behance and we will check out today's artist spotlight, which is Luis Pinto. Their work is just absolutely incredible. Danii, please feel free to pick any piece of art that you would like, and we can kind of just open up his work and just talk about it. And you can kind of talk about how you know Luis and just a little bit about his career, if you know anything.
Yeah, maybe a little bit. I love his vibrant and bold use of color. Oh, we can check out this one here. That's something I like a lot because I usually don't use blue as much, but he does a lot. So, and I absolutely love that. I love that it's so, I think it looks so free and like so dynamic and beautiful. Oh, yeah. I guess it was part of an exhibition. And yeah, also think that looks pretty delicious.
Oh yeah, I love the he has kind of a noise or a grain texture on his work that looks really nice. I like that a lot. He uses gradients too.
Yeah, love that too. The texture is nice. He also does a few animations, I think. Oh yeah, that was in a magazine. Nice.
Oh, that's beautiful. Yeah. Oh wow. That, and he did like a more realistic portrait too. That was really cool.
I think that was in the magazine.
Oh, okay. In the magazine. Okay. I was going to say, wow, he has a lot of range.
Yeah. And look, these, they're so cute and vibrant and powerful. Really love them. Yeah. We're at the same agency. That's how I got to know him. And also, the first time I saw his work was when I got the inquiry for UPS, which he also did. He did the envelope.
Oh, cool.
And I was like, oh, I love that. That's cool and powerful and awesome. Yeah, and then I figured out, that we're at the same agency. And I'm like, oh, that's pretty cool.
I just love how much it looks like his culture has influenced his artwork quite a bit. It's very beautiful. I love the very traditional Hispanic look to his work. It's really, really nice, and the bright, vibrant colors.
Yes. Really is amazing. And yeah, you can clearly see it here as well. Yeah, and as you said, I really love the structure also he uses here. Yeah, and that he's so like, I feel like it doesn't look the same. Like, it always looks new to me. Even though I can clearly see it's his work, like, it's so recognizable, but I'm surprised and happy to see new things of him. Yeah, and I love how he presents his work. It's really, like, awesome. Yeah, even the sketches already look so loose and, like, fresh and...
Yeah, he does a really great job of keeping... He starts out with a really loose sketch, it looks like, and then he keeps that looseness even after he adds color. I think that a lot of artists can struggle with that sometimes. So that's very impressive that he's able to keep that character when he's adding color and finishing it up. There's so much detail too. Like, wow.
Yes, incredibly a lot. Yeah. And I love the white lines he does.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, also good to see. Yeah, so much detail. I love it. I wish, I have to add more also. Really have to. It's inspiring me.
Everyone in chat is loving his work.
Oh, there are even like scars. Awesome.
Oh, that's so cool. Wow. It's always so fun to see the artwork on an actual product. Wow, that looks beautiful in that restaurant with all the plants around it and everything. That's gorgeous. Yeah.
Perfect. Yeah. And even a tiger. He can do it all. Like, I would totally struggle with tigers and animals in general.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that's somebody else. Where is the tiger? Yeah. Where is it?
We'll get there. It's a big group project.
Yeah. Oh, there's quite more I can see on the side. Ooh. Yeah, okay. I'm not sure if I'm finding it. Let's watch something else. Yeah, he also did the Adobe Creative Residency.
Oh, very cool. I didn't know that.
I didn't know either. Oh, yeah.
I love these colors that he used in this. It's totally different than what we were seeing before in his other work. He kind of used a lot of warm tones, and these are kind of cool tones. Very pretty.
Yeah, definitely big color talent here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, is there something you wanted to see?
I would like to see, let's look at, I think if you scroll down a little bit, I think Paco was saying earlier that there was a Star Wars artwork that I had not seen yet. Maybe. I don't know for sure. Maybe. I could be wrong. Wow, he has a lot of work on Behance, even just scrolling through. Oh, he's got some Metroid work too. Oh, I like to see the fan art. That's fun.
Yeah.
The Monster Project. That's pretty.
Yeah. Oh, and you can clearly also see, you can always see it's him, but also see his progress as an artist.
Yeah. Yeah, and his older work. Oh, yeah, there's some Star Wars artwork right there on the right.
Where is it? on the right.
The one
the
that says Star Wars The Force Awakens.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah. Wow.
Amazing. Love the flames coming out. Oh, the
lightsaber.
Yeah.
Wow, that's so much crazy detail. It's so cool to see, like you were saying just a second ago, his progress in him refining his style, because this looks like it's a little bit of an older piece. So he had kind of more of a realism detail back then, but he still used his bright colors, which is really cool.
Yeah, but also you can clearly see like he had this other side already. Like,
yeah.
But no texture. Yet.
Yeah,
but still, like, it's all already there and so refined by the end. Oh man, I love those. So cool.
All right, you guys, yeah, don't forget to follow Luis if you're interested in his work. Please feel free to follow him on Behance, check out his other social media as well. I'm sure he would really appreciate the follow. And we can hop on back into Fresco whenever you're ready to do so, Danii, and we can just finish off the last 15-ish minutes left in the stream, working on the rest of the colors here.
Time flies again.
Yes.
Yeah, unfortunately, some of the details get lost. Let me put there some more on top. Yeah, I have to figure it out. I'm going to post this work definitely on my Instagram, probably on Monday the latest, I hope. I'm going to finish it for sure if I might not be able to do it today, which is, yeah, I think can very much happen because it's only 15 minutes left.
But, don't forget to follow Danii on Behance and Instagram, by the way, if you'd like to see this finished piece whenever she uploads it.
As soon as possible. I promise you don't have to wait too long. Yeah, maybe she can even have like white eyeshadow or something. Could look fun.
Yeah, it really pops. That's really fun.
Yeah, especially because the skin is like off white-ish. The gradient doesn't seem so right. Yeah, I think that's a bit better.
Yeah, making artwork is a lot of just figuring things out as you go, I think. And I think that's something that maybe a beginner artist might not realize, that, you know, it might seem like a professional artist just knows what they're doing all the time, which is not true at all. We work and figure things out and problem solve as we're creating our artwork as well. There's a lot of problem solving that goes into making art, especially if you're working on a client project that you've never done before. Sometimes on the inside you might feel like you can't do it, but on the outside you might not see that side of the artist. So art's a lot more difficult than professionals make it seem sometimes.
That's absolutely true. But that's also what I personally love a lot. Like the challenge and like figuring things out on the go. But yeah, definitely something I had to learn. Also, because the perfectionism comes into the way a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's really like kind of like letting go of things. Like, oh no, let's go with the flow.
Yes.
It's gonna be fine. Will you be able to do it right from the start, or to be so, how can I say that? Yeah, chill about the process that you didn't like, or did you kill lots and lots and lots of your artwork?
Oh, I am definitely a perfectionist, and I still struggle with that. And I also struggle with getting attached to my artwork too. Where if I've spent a lot of time on a piece, I have a hard time throwing it away. I just keep working at it. And then I get frustrated with myself because it's not turning out the way I want it to. But I think I've gotten better about being willing to, just start over. It's hard though. It's hard to not get attached to the artwork that you create.
Yeah. I feel like fashion school really, helped me learn that lesson more quickly. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know if anybody watched like Making the Cut.
Yeah.
Those, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was 4 years of my life. It was like that. It truly,
wow.
That's your life. Like make the impossible possible.
Yeah.
And I think I haven't cried this much in a year studying fashion design, because it really is intense, but it's also like I've learned so much, for example, like time management, I'm really good at, like to overlook the project and see what I'm able to be doing or what is not possible anymore and communicate that clearly. I'm very thankful for the experience. It really did a lot for me, for my life, actually.
Yeah.
Like there were so many important lessons learned.
Yeah, so it was hard in the moment, but you're happy that you experienced it, even though it was difficult.
Definitely, yeah. But yeah, that's also why I love to watch those TV shows so much.
Yeah.
Because it like kicks me right back into 4 years of my life. And I'm like being very passionate about it. Like, yeah, you can do it. So I'll put her earrings.
Oh, how did you create that star shape?
Oh, it was in the shapes. Like shapes by default, like a square or a rectangle or a circle or a triangle, or as you can see, the star.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you can even like change up everything about this, which I like to do a lot, actually, because I like when stuff is a little bit more individual.
Mm-hmm.
Love to like change the stars, make them not too perfect.
Hi, Laura. Welcome to the chat. She just popped in and said, wow, I love what Danii did with the composition and the colors. So lots of fans in chat of the composition and colors. Very nice.
Thank you so much. So happy to hear that. So sad I didn't completely finish.
That is totally fine. Honestly, it hardly ever happens that somebody finishes artwork on the stream. I never finish artwork on the stream. So it's totally normal.
Yeah, last time I was able to finish, but yeah, not this time. Yeah, she at least is almost already there. Maybe we can start like putting some brighter dots. I can't take pink anymore because it's in the background. Maybe I have to add white to the palette eventually.
Oh, mm-hmm.
But yeah, for now, trying with the off-white. But yeah, now I choose the circle again. Ooh. Yeah, and I really prefer to do just one dot for the clipping mask and then add the other, because I feel like it stays more stable that way and the program doesn't have to work as hard. So yeah, now I can copy them easier.
Laura is also asking, she said, this is so inspiring. Does Danii have any courses? Do you have any online classes or anything that you offer?
Unfortunately, I don't. But you can always ask me. Just like message me on Behance or Instagram, and I'm happy to answer any questions that might occur.
I love the polka dots. That's so fun.
Yeah, love a good dotted pants.
Yes. So stylish.
Doing the clipping mask once more. Yeah, it's slowly getting there.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Yeah, let me try something with the background. I feel like maybe it needs like a contrast color. Huh.
That's interesting.
Yeah, maybe a dark blue could work out. Also makes much more sense with the multiplied layers of the wave.
Yeah.
Or a dark green could also be awesome. Oh, yeah. I actually think I kind of prefer that one.
That's nice.
Oh,
it really makes the... Sorry, go ahead.
No.
I was just going to say it really makes the pink pop.
Yes, exactly. Oh, I like it.
Pink and green always look great together.
So true. Always works. I think she's getting some quick sunglasses because I think that's the coolest.
Yes. Again, so stylish. We have probably just a few minutes left, and then we're going to start wrapping up so we can just keep working on these sunglasses and facial features, and then we will be about ready to head out.
I can't believe it's over. Almost.
Annika says, I love how much work Danii did in 2 days of streams. I know, you're concerned that you didn't finish it. I'm impressed that you did so much.
Yeah?
Yeah. That's a lot of work. Yeah, you did so many characters.
Yeah, yesterday I was impressed as well, to be honest. I have to, like, I was so scared, but yeah, I was like, yeah, I need the challenge. Maybe I can do it. I can do it.
And then, yeah.
Yeah, and I wanted the top to have stripes. Let's make them white. And then, yeah, I think I'm ready to stop for now and finish this afterwards. Yeah,
the clipping mouse. Yeah, the clipping mouse are really helpful. Go ahead. Sorry.
My favorites. What did you want to say?
I was just going to say, I like the stripes on the top because it's very different compared to the spots. So it kind of has a lot of nice contrast.
Ooh. Yeah, always lock the layers. Always when it gets worse when you're in a hurry, right? And you start to like hurry up and then all the mistakes are happening. But yeah, it's really getting there. So yeah. Happy with it. Yeah.
Well, that is awesome, Danii. And we really so much appreciate you being here for the last 2 days. If you guys missed either stream, you can feel free to check it out over on the Adobe Live YouTube channel. And don't forget to follow us over there. Shortly after this stream, we will be having the Pro Tips Bootcamp with Evan Abrams, and he will be showing how to edit videos in Adobe After Effects. And then after that, we will have Storm Stewart as she shows how to animate illustrations in After Effects as well. So After Effects afternoon. and then, thank you all so much for joining us. And also don't forget to follow Danii on social media as well, as I've mentioned before. Thank you so much for joining us today and yesterday, Danii. We really appreciate you being here.
Yeah, thank you so much, everybody, for coming here and watching us. I had such a great time. Thank you so much, so much. It was amazing. So excited to post the final artwork and soon.
yeah, soon. Not right away, but soon. Yeah. All right, you guys. Thank you all so much for joining. Laura, Oliver, Annika, everyone in chat. Stick around for the Pro Tips Bootcamp up next. Bye, guys.
Bye.